Alrighty, so welcome to the first News of the Week episode of the 2022 MLS regular season. And since now the regular season has begun, I'm going to go back to where I'm only going to do one News of the Week episode per week, since, you know, during the regular season, there isn't going to be as much news that's going to be involving some transfer signings and also so outbounding transfer around MLS. Though there was one big signings that happened just today. And that came from the Houston Dynamo, who they officially signed Mexican international midfielder Hector Herrera as a designated player from Atletico Madrid. Now, I'm kind of surprised the fact that this deal got done so fast. I mean, it wasn't long before the Dynamo was linked with Hector Herrera. And that, again, you know, I would think that the negotiation process would be much longer than it is. Though, I have heard the fact that maybe Atletico Madrid was ready to kind of take any offer, because, you know, Hector Herrera was kind of falling out with Atletico Madrid, and it seemed like he maybe think about leaving either to another European team or the other option of going to MLS. But there's no doubt that I think this definitely reached a lot of eyeballs, and especially, you know, for a team that is the Houston Dynamo. I mean, this team is kind of unrecognizable as what we saw a couple of years ago in terms of some of their signing. And it's in a good way too, because, you know, this team has always known as one of the cheapest team in the league and still have that kind of MLS 1.0 mindset. And I gotta give a lot of credit to their new owner, Ted Seagulls. I mean, he said that he was going to spend some money and be ambitious. And this is probably the most ambitious signing the Dynamo has made, probably since when they signed DeMarcus Beasley back in 2014. But yeah, there's no doubt that this is a huge signing for the Dynamo, and that I said before that, you know, this is also going to be a signing that definitely will get fans into the stadium. Like, you know, Houston is a city that has a big Latino population, but also a huge Mexican population. And consider you got a guy that is considered a star in the Mexican international team, and still is. Yeah, that's going to get a lot of people to watch the game at BBVA Compass Stadium. And although, you know, some of them might not actually just kind of root for the Houston Dynamo, I think the Dynamo will take it. And especially with the attendance problem that they've been having, this is definitely going to be one that's going to hugely boost the attendance. And also the fact that, you know, I mean, for me, I still feel like this, they're still kind of in a rebuilding mode. Though, you know, this is definitely a signing for them to try to accelerate this rebuild, and maybe they're not just gonna suck for the entire year and have a difference maker like Hector Herrera. Because again, going forward on the attack, I think they're pretty decent in terms of that spot. Though, you know, there is still that question in terms of the number 9 position and who is going to be there. But in terms of the number 10 and the winger position, they're pretty good in terms of that spot too. So, you know, maybe I think the Dynamo might surprise some people with that. Maybe they could have the enough talent to not actually finish dead last in the standing and actually make their way up in the Western Conference. Now, St. Louis SC have made another signing, and they have made their second signing of their team heading into expansion year next season, as they sign midfielder Thomas Oshka from FC Cologne. Now, I don't really know a lot about this player, and I haven't heard whether or not if he is decent or not. But knowing the fact that when you're an expansion team and you, of course, sign a guy that, you know, we'll see if he is actually a guy that maybe will be maybe be a starter for the team. I mean, I'm assuming it is, because when you sign a player from the first division, or actually not the first, is I forgot if Cologne is still in the Bundesliga, or they got relegated last season. But either way, you know, I think it's a decent signing for St. Louis. And again, St. Louis is definitely trying to avoid what Charlotte did in their inaugural season, which is they wait too long to build their roster. They want to get their roster done and so that they can ready for their expansion year, because for you know it, the season is going to be, or the expansion season is going to finally begin for the St. Louis team. Now, NYCFC have signed midfielder Maximo Carrizo to become the youngest homegrown in league history. And again, you know, anytime when I talk about homegrown signing, I usually don't talk about in the News of the Week episode, because it feels like every single week there's a homegrown player that is signed for an MLS team, and it just gets to a point where that's a little bit too much. But this is definitely a historic moment, and in some way it was kind of surprising the fact that, you know, just I think a couple of months ago when RSL signed Axel Kai as the youngest MLS player in history. I thought that record was going to maybe stand for a bit. And the fact that in just the past couple of months, this record has broken twice, that, you know, once Freddie Adu basically hold the record of becoming the youngest player in league history. I mean, it just shows you how MLS has really started to evolve in a situation where a lot of these teams are giving chances to a lot of these homegrown players. And it's not just any homegrown player, but these homegrown player that is incredibly young. And, you know, we'll see whether or not in the future he's going to be decent. I mean, you know, there's no doubt that he's not going to just go straight into the NYCFC team. I mean, he's got a long career under him. And especially, I think he's probably going to be one of those players that is going to be part of the second team of NYCFC in the MLS Next Pro. And by the way, that is also another reason why I think we're starting to see teams that are signing homegrown player that is like 15 or 14 year old. I mean, a couple of years ago, that would be very unprecedented to see like teams signing 14 or 15 years old. But nowadays, I think it's kind of just shows you that, yeah, these teams want to produce themselves some good homegrown talent and basically able to develop them in a way where maybe they can sell them off to Europe or even get them into the first team. But it definitely helps the fact that, you know, with MLS Next Pro being launched this season, a lot of these players will be playing in that, and they actually will get competitive minutes, unlike how they're probably just going to be sitting on the bench throughout the season. Now, moving on in terms of the next news, and now talk about some injuries news, because, you know, the season has begun, and unfortunately, every time when we talk about this part of the segment, yeah, this is definitely a part that it's kind of sad to see, because usually we talk about some injury that could potentially be season-ending injury. But the good news is there was no season-ending injury after the first week, though. We did had an injury coming from Atlanta United, as Luis Araujo is going to be out for 4 weeks with a hamstring injury. So I talked about before in the review how he actually came out of that game with a hamstring injury, and that sounds about right. You know, usually hamstring takes about four to 6 weeks to heal, and that, you know, for Atlanta, definitely going to suffer a little bit of a blow in terms of the attack, because we know what Araujo can bring to the table for this Atlanta team. But the good news is at least it's going to only be out for 4 weeks, and they should have him back as soon as next month. Now, Uri Russell also out with a hamstring injury for a couple of weeks, while Jose Mari actually was being cut from Sporting KC. And actually, I think this was still only reported in terms of the latter part. I mean, we know that Uri Russell is not going to be with the Sporting KC team for a bit, but it's kind of surprised that Jose Mari was basically just flat out cut from the team. I mean, I know that he had a terrible game against Atlanta United, and it's so terrible that Peter Vermees basically subbed him on and then basically subbed him back out just 20 minutes later. And that's something you don't usually see, and usually that only happens when you just have a terrible kind of performance. But it just doesn't get to a point where I thought a player just simply is just being cut from the team. And that, again, I think this definitely sends some message to the Sporting KC team, and maybe this is just a move for Peter Vermees to tell his team that, yeah, no squad in their team is definitely needs, or no position in their team is definitely safe. You need to, of course, perform, and if you do not perform even in a game that you come on, you are definitely going to face the consequences. So yeah, you know it. You know, that's definitely an example of that. And again, we'll see whether or not if Jose Mari might get picked up by another team now that he's been cut from Sporting KC. Now, Nathan from the San Jose Earthquakes, he is going to be out for 2 months with a torn meniscus. Now, in some way, I was kind of glad that this was only 2 months. I mean, I know 2 months is definitely a long time. And, you know, knowing the fact that the Quakes are just such a dumpster fire after their first game. Yeah, losing Nathan, their most important defender, is definitely going to hurt what's already been a very fragile back line. But as I said before, I was worried the fact that this was going to be a torn ACL, and especially with the way that he was carried off the field, looked like this was going to be serious. But fortunately, you know, still, I know a torn meniscus is definitely not a good feeling for Nathan to have to feel, and he's going to be out for a bit, but at least it's not a long-term injury. And that hopefully he'll have a good speedy recovery, and we can of course get him back during the summer, because I think also during that time, you know, I'm thinking that that is the time when maybe the Quakes finally decide that they're going to do the right thing. And that, of course, is fire Almeida and probably maybe do the ultimate right thing, which is finally demand John Fisher to sell this team, because we know that those two problems are really the culprit in terms of the fact that I think the Quakes are going to be in for a very difficult season. Now, moving on in terms of the next news, and now talking about some transfer rumors. Now, Barcelona defender Sergi Roberto is reported to activate an option to move to MLS. Now, the way that they kind of worded this was kind of strange, because I didn't know a player can actually have an option in their contract clause that they can just go to MLS. And by the way, the latest team that is linked with Sergi Roberto is the LA Galaxy, which is not a big surprise, because, you know, they're a team that loves to sign some big name European player. And while Roberto is definitely not one of those, he is a guy that, of course, is definitely well known, especially in the Barcelona fan base. And yeah, you know, we'll see whether or not if he is going to be going to the Galaxy, and if that is the case, it's definitely going to be an upgrade for this Galaxy backline. Though, again, we'll see how much they, of course, would pay for him. And especially, I don't think the Galaxy actually have an open DP spot available. I mean, I know Chicharito and also Douglas Costa basically occupy the DP spot. Actually, I might be wrong, though. I think they might have an open DP spot. Though, again, I've said before, where when you sign a defender on a designated player contract, do at your own risk, because we know how that's one of the unofficial rule of the DP rule in MLS, where you're not supposed to spend that on a defender. And I know the Galaxy, they have had some issue with their backline of what seems like forever, but this feels like it could be a big gamble if they decided to sign him on a DP contract, even though I know he's definitely going to be decent if he's going to be coming to MLS. Now, speaking of defender, Toronto FC is looking to try to sign another defender, this time signing Genoa defender Domenico Cristoco from Genoa. Actually, that seems like it's a little bit reiterate there, because we know that he's from Genoa, that is. So let me just erase that. Now, from what I heard is that it seems like he is actually still injured, and that he has been on the IR since December. So something tells me that looks like it's a serious injury that he suffered. And again, you know, this is a bit of a risk that TFC is going to do when you sign a guy that is currently injured, and you don't know when exactly he's going to be able to get off the IR. But especially with the way that, you know, he's been kind of out for 3 months now, you know, it seems like it's something that is a bit serious. And especially if it's going to continue for these next couple of months, it's definitely going to be a serious injury. And, you know, when a guy comes back from a serious injury, it's tough to try to make an impact immediately for a team. And it just feels like this is kind of the signing that they want to hope that he can make a good impact to that defense and kind of reshape that defense too, because we know that this is a team that last season, besides FC Cincinnati, gave up the most goal in the league, and they want to change that back line so that they can stabilize that position and maybe get themselves back to be an MLS Cup contender in the Eastern Conference. Now, moving on to other news that is either related to MLS and or overseas. Patrice Bernier was named the name and inducted into the Canadian Soccer Hall of Fame. So congratulations to Patrice Bernier, who is definitely considered one of the best defender in MLS, or not just, yeah, one of the best defender in MLS, and certainly a legend for the Montreal Impacts and in the Canadian soccer national team. And it's, again, no surprise the fact that he, of course, is inducted in the Canadian Soccer Hall of Fame like that. Now, moving on, in terms of the next news, we got Leeds United actually named Jesse Marsh as their new head coach. Now, this was actually a rumor a couple of weeks ago that Jesse Marsh was going to potentially coach Leeds United, and if that, of course, is the case, he's become the second head coach, or the second American head coach to coach in the Premier League after Bob Bradley did with Swansea City a couple years ago. And yeah, that did not go well, as Bob Bradley was immediately fired from that team just a couple of months in. And I just fear that this could be the same case for Jesse Marsh too. I mean, we know Jesse Marsh is kind of a trailblazer in terms of being an American head coach, trying to make an impact in the European game and trying to coach these big team. And while he had some relatively good success with RB Salzburg, That was not the case with RB Leipzig. I mean, that was kind of a disaster round that eventually got him fired. And now he's going to be joining a team that is fighting for relegation and a team that just had one of their most beloved head coach being fired in Marcelo Bielsa. Yeah, there's a lot of pressure for Jesse Marsch coming into this game. And again, it's not just because of the pressure of relegation, but also the fan base. I from what I heard from the Leeds United fan base, they're not happy with this move because they know that last time when we saw an American head coach in the Premier League, it was a total disaster, and it seems like this might be a move that could be heading to that point where it can even actually get them relegated this season. But again, we'll see if that's going to be the case. And you know, again, I also feel like this is kind of a move that, you know, for Jesse Marsch, I feel like, you know, he still is going to be a guy that will consider to be an American head coach that definitely trying to create this new realm where a lot of these good American head coach in MLS could potentially go to Europe to take a big job for a big name club. But I just feel like this is a huge risk for his reputation, because if he does not do well with Leeds United, yeah, his reputation is going to be damaged heading into this new job. And then finally, the last news that we're going to talk about isn't kind of directly related to MLS, but it's kind of indirectly, because the MLB has officially announced that they will cancel opening day and a couple of series leading into the 2022 regular season because of the ongoing lockout that is happening. Now, as a person that love baseball, and you know I always go to a lot of Giants games, this definitely is a bit disheartening, and especially the fact that it doesn't help. The fact that we kind of saw this coming with the way that the MLB PA and also probably the most idiotic commissioner in the world right now in Rob Manfred, and also the owners kind of having some bickering with each other. Yeah, it looks like this is going to be a long negotiation that could maybe not even just cancel the first couple of series, but maybe in the entire season at all. And I think this also is kind of a good reminder that MLS came very close to be at that point. Remember back in 2021 when there was definitely a big threat that the MLS regular season was going to be postponed because of the ongoing CBA, and I talked about how, yeah, this does not look good, and that somehow maybe both sides will eventually come together. Unfortunately, literally at the 11th hour, they agree on a deal, and that I'm just glad we don't have to worry about that until a couple years later. But yeah, you know, it's sad to see what's going on with baseball, and especially with the way that, you know, baseball is definitely a sport that is dying, and that, you know, this is definitely going to be something that's going to be losing some of the diehard fans that actually support the team. I mean, I still like baseball, even if it is definitely seen as a dying sport, but it's definitely sad to see the situation that they're going through. Though, you know, in some way, this is kind of good news for MLS because, again, you know, knowing the fact that if MLB is going to continue to cancel game, and especially if this lockout continue into the summer, MLS have no competition at all. Like, you know, once the NBA and the NHL season, and I think the NHL season end in June, and the same goes with the NBA. And if the MLB continue to cancel games and basically the lockout continue into the summer, MLS will really be the only league that is going to be dominant in the American landscape. And this is a huge opportunity for this league to really be on the center stage, because, you know, we talk about how this league for the past couple of years, it has really grown into popularity. And I have definitely read a lot of article talking about how, you know, this league could actually should be becoming the one of the top league in the American sports landscape in a couple of years, and that some even say that it might even overtake the NHL as the fourth most popular sports in the American sports landscape. But of course, with this MLB situation that's getting ugly, and the fact that the league continue to grow and more fans and the ratings start to continue to go up, yeah, I mean, this is definitely good news for MLS, and that I really think in 10 years time, this league could maybe be the third or even the second. Well, I would say the third most watched league, or the third most popular league in the U.S. sports landscape. Because after all, I think nobody's going to beat the NFL. I mean, I think it would be way too ambitious for me to say that MLS will consider to be the most watched league in in the American sports landscape, because like I said, you know, there's that thing called the NFL that will always hold that crown, and then of course the NBA also kind of going through the same growth and are really challenging the NFL in terms of that. But there's no doubt that MLS will pass the NHL and MLB in terms of that in these next 10 years, and yeah, it's good to see, because again, you know, it's hard to believe this league was only founded just 27 years ago, and that, you know, it's great to see the league has grown, and it's also great to see that more people are watching a league that definitely has a really bright future in these next couple of years. But either way, hope you guys enjoy this video. If you do, make sure you guys leave a like, smash the subscribe button. As always, let me know in the comments below what do you think of these news, and if there's any news I didn't mention here on the board, let me know in the comments below. But yeah, hope you guys enjoy this video, and I will see you guys next time.